New Hanover County Senior Resource Center presents Living Legacy, a collection of personal stories from our seniors. Through autobiographical storytelling, we can learn more about years past and present as we move to the future. We hope you enjoy.
My full name is Floyd John Nelson. I go by John, and that causes great confusion between Floyd and John, but we get by with that.
Can you tell me why your parents chose your name?
Well, yes. My grandfather was John Colgan, and my father was Floyd Nelson. So they made concessions and named me both.
And did you have a nickname when you were growing up?
Oh, I had several nicknames. One of my earliest was J.C., which was John Colgan, which my maternal grandmother sort of had a little jealousy thing there. And it was sort of Jesus Christ and John Colgan. And then J.C. mutated into J.C. Then in high school, I was Jake. And in college, I was a number.
Can you tell me when and where you were born?
I was born in Steubenville, Ohio, May 11th, 1939. Okay. 3 months before Poland was invaded by the Germans.
Mm-hmm. Do you know why your parents chose Ohio?
Well, I do. I've actually been into ancestry.com. And way back to 1700 and some. And it turns out the Nelsons were coal miners. And my earliest Robert Nelson came from England, Newcastle, I think it was. And then the Colgans were Irish, and they came over, settled around Pittsburgh. My maternal grandfather actually was born in Philadelphia, raised in Ireland, and then he came back to the United States when he was 16. He said he had a fight with a priest and they threw him out of Ireland.
How long did you live in Ohio?
I lived in Ohio. I went to Ohio State, married my wife there. She's from Columbus. And we left to Ohio when I was 22. Went to Penn State for 2 years, and then we came back and I worked for Wheeling Steel for 2 years. Then that was the end of Ohio. We went to Massachusetts, Illinois, Chicago, Argentina, back to Chicago. We came here in 1990. Mm-hmm. We moved in the day I-40 opened.
So many other people came right after that.
Well, I told my wife, we had a place on the beach. I said, you know, that road is going to change everything, but we're going to make a lot of money over it. So, and it all happened that way.
Well. So tell me, do you have any siblings?
I had one brother. Okay. He and his wife were killed simultaneously in an automobile accident in 1962. Their children weren't with them, and his oldest daughter is 63 now.
Thinking back, what's your earliest childhood memory?
My earliest childhood memory is my mother being baptized. They kept me in the car, which was up on a bridge, looking down into the creek. We said creek in Ohio. And there she was, and I thought she had a sheet on her. I was probably about 3. And they dunked her into the water, and you know, that's number one.
What kind of games did you play when you were growing up?
Oh, all the stuff that kids of the 40s did, baseball, football. I wasn't much of an athlete. I tried and decided after a while that just wasn't my bag, and you know, education was, and that's where I excelled. I was the valedictorian of my high school class.
Wow. Yeah. What year did you graduate from school?
1957.
Wow. Mm.
Got a scholarship to Ohio State. In fact, I was offered several scholarships, and I thought that was the best one. So,
and so you're a Buckeye fan.
I am, and when they beat Alabama, that was something.
What's your favorite type of songs or favorite type of music?
Oh, I like songs with melodies. They seem to be in short supply anymore. We go to church. I like the good old hymns, the slower. Yeah, the songs of the 50s and 60s when you're in high school. That's what you remember.
Songs that kind of take you back to that
time. Oh, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Elvis. Maybe Beatles a little bit. I wasn't that old that I couldn't appreciate the Beatles.
So what do you think about today's music?
It's hard to call much of it music, in my opinion. The church we go to, they have this incredible loud bass, and it literally crushes your chest. Mm-hmm. And anytime I hear something like that, I tell my wife, church music. Yeah. It's the modern style. It draws the younger demographic. I know what they're trying to do, but yeah, I came from a different era. Yeah. And
so you came from a time when, you know, Elvis was coming about and the new age of rock and roll.
Yeah, I remember it in high school. In the senior year, we tried to raise enough money to take a trip to Washington, D.C. And we did various things. Well, one was to sell hot dogs at the county fairs. There were two county fairs we did. And Elvis was, "You ain't nothing but a hound dog." And that was, what, 56, I suppose.
Yep. Who were your childhood heroes?
Oh, who were my childhood heroes? Wow. Probably soldiers in World War II. And a lot of them came back. We'll get into World War II eventually, I suppose. But they just had the right stuff. That they not only fought wars, they came back and they built businesses and you know, built this country up.
Yep. Mm. So this we'll probably get into with World War II, I'd imagine. But what world events has had the most impact on you while growing up?
Oh, probably 9/11. I mean, you know, that was worse than Pearl Harbor. And I was on my way to a customer in South Carolina, was trapped in a car, didn't know it had happened until we got to the customer, and everybody was gathered around a TV. It's like, what's going on? They said, "Oh, two airplanes hit New York City," and nobody knew what was going on at that moment. Are we at war? They grounded all the planes.
How was the world different from what it was like when you were a child?
Well, we didn't have helicopter parents. My mother would say hello and goodbye in the morning, and at 9 o'clock when I came in from playing, and "Are you hungry?" And kids were let to do what they wanted. You know, that's good and that's bad. Maybe what they want is not the right things, but now with the helicopter parents, it's like a helmet on and gloves and a backpack, and if the kid fell down, you probably couldn't get up.
Do you feel that when you were growing up, the world was a safer place than it is today?
Yeah. Safer in that if we needed to, we were going to go fight a war. There was no holding back, and Korea proved that. But now it's like ISIS, all the splinter groups, they just keep pecking away, and we just keep saying, no, no, no. Yeah.
Are there any stories or famous or infamous people in your family?
Oh, sure. One of the things I found remarkable is I had an Uncle Harry, and he was in the insane asylum in Cambridge, Ohio. And that's all I ever knew. We'd go out to visit Uncle Harry, and well, I found digging through all the ancestry.com, Uncle Harry had been gassed in World War I. And that's what was wrong with him. He wasn't crazy, he was injured. And
so it sounds like you really remember, you know, those times going and visiting him.
Yeah.
When and where did you meet your spouse?
Her name was Joanne Pritchard. I met her at a roller rink, Smith's, in Columbus, Ohio, while going to Ohio State. I skated with her, and I said, "You going to be here next week?" And she says, "Yeah." And I said, "Well, then I'll be back." Week two, she wasn't there. Week three, she wasn't there. Week four, I don't know why I hung on that long. She showed up again. And, you know, we just went from there. In the meantime, she had told her mother, "I met the guy I'm going to marry." She knew it and I didn't.
How long did you date before?
About a year.
How old were you when you got married?
I was 21.
How old was she?
18.
18.
Different times.
Yeah. Yes.
Our grandson just got married and he's 27. And
how long were you married?
56 years.
So if you had to give advice to someone who is just getting married or is newly married, what's the key to a successful marriage?
Well, I've had practice at this because my grandson just got married. Give, forgive. And don't be in such a hurry. I told my younger grandson that. He just graduated from college a year ago. Spent a year as a music teacher in Illinois. And I said, "Look, Mike," I said, "you're going to live a long time, probably longer than me. And don't get in a hurry. Things will happen." And I've seen a lot of divorce, or every one of our children is on the second marriage. And I don't understand that phenomena. It's like, "I'll get married, but I'm not going to put up with anything." And,
Yeah, I imagine over the many years that you and your wife were married, that, you know, there was hard times.
Oh, sure.
Which overcome.
Sure. Yeah. Yes, I remember our first year of marriage, eating lettuce and vinegar, because that's all we had and no money. I was a fifth year engineering student, and she had just lost her job. She worked in a shoe store, and they said goodbye.
But you survived.
Oh, sure.
Mm-hmm. So how many children do you have?
We have three children.
Okay.
Girl, boy, girl. The youngest is 51, the second is 52, and the third is 53.
Oh, well, back to back.
Oh, yeah, we get teased about that. But you know what? We've had a whole second life since they left home, and we traveled a lot. It was like, this is what we paid our dues for, and now we're doing it.
So what's your proudest moment of being a parent?
Oh, probably my son getting his PhD.
Wow. Do they live locally or do they live elsewhere?
One of them lives locally, our oldest, Lisa. And I'll tell you the story about that. It's L-E-I-S-S-A.
Oh.
Nobody gets that right. Mm-hmm. Lisa is named for Dr. Arthur Lisa at Ohio State. In my fifth year of engineering at Ohio State, I was taking graduate courses as well as undergraduate courses to get a master's degree in 5 years. So that was a pretty good deal. Well, my advisor in the mining engineering department had not officially applied for graduate credit, all those courses. I got straight A's in every one of them. And they said, well, you're going to have to take over XYZ classes. It would have cost me another year of college. And I thought, I paid for his mistake? So I went to him and I said, well, you tell the graduate committee you made a mistake. And his answer was, no.
Wow.
So, Dr. Arthur Lisa in engineering mechanics, whom I had worked for grading papers and learned to program a computer at his behest, I took my case to him and he said, I'll see what I can do. He got me credit, I graduated on time, and I named my firstborn.
Oh, firstborn was a little girl.
Yeah.
Daddy's girl, I'd imagine.
Oh, yeah. She used to ride me like a horsey.
So tell me about your profession and how did you choose it?
I don't know whether I chose it or it chose me, but in my third year at Ohio State, you have to declare a major. It's just, mm-hmm. you know, generic engineering up to then. And I had worked in coal mines, surface, underground. And I thought, this is good. You don't sit behind a desk all the time. You get outside, you move, you do things. I think I want to be a mining engineer. Okay. So I did. And during my last year, there was a scholastic test to get a fellowship. I just wanted to go be an engineer. In fact, I had been interviewed by U.S. Steel to come work at their coal mine. Their coal mine, they had many of them. And I thought that's the way it was going to go. Well, this classmate of mine, John Patterson, he and I were rivals. And he was going to take the test. And I thought, I can beat him. So I took the test, and I beat him, and I got a fellowship. That's like, well, if they're giving you money, I guess you should take it. So I went to Penn State on that fellowship. And I still wasn't that committed to it. And my advisor there says, did you renew the NSF fellowship? And I said, no, I let it lapse. And he went ballistic. What? I said, well, you know. So I went and applied for the IBM fellowship, which wasn't mining engineering at all, and I got it. So the second year I stayed at Penn State and I'd finished up all the coursework. And at that point I had done some work for Wheeling Steel. And they said, we want you to come back here and work full time. The work was operations research. It was building mathematical models of processes in the steel mill. So I worked it out that I could go work for Wheeling Steel and pursue outside the thesis. Of course, I had to change the thesis topic because it just wouldn't work outside the academic environment. And at Wheeling Steel, we did some wonderful modeling work, saved them many millions of dollars. And this was at the same time that NASA had peaked and then was going down, and PhDs were a dime a dozen. And I said, I don't know whether I want to get that PhD. I think I'm going to hurt my wages. Now, that sounds like a good excuse, but anyway, I never finished it, but my son did, so. And then the rest of my career was more or less mathematical modeling and systems engineering. To do mathematical models, big ones, you need a computer. And I had a situation at Wheeling Steel where we couldn't get a big enough computer to run the mill model. And there was a place in Washington, D.C., CEIR, that had a big enough computer, so I would put a tape under my arm, get on the plane in Pittsburgh at 10 o'clock at night, fly to Washington, D.C., spend all night with the computer, have another tape of the results, come back, go to bed at 7 in the morning, and nobody knew I had been gone.
So technology has changed quite a bit since then.
Yeah, I got more power under my desk than CEIR had.
If you had to choose a different profession than what you did, what would it have been?
No, I think I was in the right profession. I like music, but I don't want to starve.
What accomplishments are you most proud of to date?
Oh, some of the computer systems we put in that one of my shining stars, I worked for Green Shoe, which was makes stride right shoes. And we put in this online order entry system. This was in 1969. And CRTs were like, what are they? Nobody knew. So we put an 8 CRT system in that controlled all the flow of shoe orders into the warehouse. And we did some amazing smart things that made that work. The computer wasn't a very big computer. And one time, a company in Boston was one of the big companies that had a really big computer. They came over and saw what we were doing, and they thought it was magic, that you couldn't possibly get that much out of that little computer. And that thing survived a long time. Long after I left it, it was still running. And I think it was maybe 10 years later before they could get rid of it. Another accomplishment, I'll sing this song. I got to learn to fly while we were in Argentina. And I came back to the United States, bought a plane. I had an Argentine ferry pilot come up, and I met him in Miami. Then the two of us took the plane down through the Andes Mountains. I mean, through. We couldn't go over. In fact, the pass that we went through was the same one that the Uruguayan soccer team had crashed in. And we went through there on a perfectly clear day at 15,005, and it was Argentine summer, it was January, but it was still all frozen. And one of the humorous parts of that trip was, before I left, I asked my boss's boss, I said, Bill Kronk, I said, you know, I want to do this. And I thought, he's going to slap me down and say no. He said, okay. And I mentioned the ferry pilot. He said, oh, is he fat? Meaning if we crashed, I was going to eat him. And then after we finished our time in Argentina, the family and I came back up the other side of South America, 18,000 miles.
Your wife must have been worried.
No, she wasn't. She had more faith than I deserved in my abilities. We had some scrapes. We got into a thunderstorm over the Amazon jungle. In fact, all of this I have on our website. It's called Ida y Vuelta, which in Spanish means round trip.
Oh, nice. Yep. What is your biggest life-changing event?
I suppose getting old and living with it. Realizing that as hard as you try, you really can't do some of those things you used to. I'm holding a 60th high school class reunion this fall. Half the classmates are gone.
And that's in Ohio?
Mm-hmm.
What is the one thing you most want people to remember about you?
Well, I've told my wife what I want on my tombstone. Is this okay to? Yeah. Is model maker. As a kid, I made model airplanes. As an adult, I made mathematical models. In fact, we bought the plot, and where it is, they recently put a great big gas pipeline near the cemetery. And I thought, imagine spending eternity listening to that gas going through that pipeline.
So tell me about what hobbies or jobs that you do today.
Oh, I'd have to call World War II Remembered is my big hobby. Let me give you a little history of the group. Is that okay at this point?
Please.
I had an old friend by the name of Jack Hart. Any of you knew Jack Hart? Mm-hmm. He was in charge of the Metropolitan Transit Authority for a while. He was a World War II veteran. He was in North Africa and Burma. And he would call into a radio talk show called Chris Watkins. And I'd listen to him, and I thought, this guy makes a lot of sense. I'd like to meet him. So I was talking it over with Joe, my wife, and she says, well, he's a bank customer. And I said, I want to meet him. She says, okay, next time he comes in the bank, I'm going to call you, and I'll hold him here till you get here. And a wonderful friendship came of that. Well, the World War II Remembered group was formed in 98, and it got into the papers. So I said, Jack, do you want to go to that? Now, Jack had macular degeneration, so he couldn't drive. So I said, I'll take you. So we started coming to the meetings, probably about 1999. And it was just World War II guys getting together to swap truths and lies and coffee. But it was interesting. So I started getting into the group, and I said, how about an outreach program where we do more than just come here once a month and have a meeting? Let's go to the schools. So we did that. Well, the original founder, Jim Holdford, he didn't last long. I think it was about 2 years after formation that he died. The second was Thor Ronnegan. Thor had fought in the Battle of the Bulge. He was quite the guy. And he took over, and he lasted about 2 to 3 years, and he had a stroke. So here we are without a leader. And one of the older women, she was a whack in World War II, decided, let's just have a bunch of committees. And that was the kiss of death. The committees don't do anything, they just talk. So the group was starting to fade to nothing. And I said, I'll tell you what, I'll step up, I'll do the programs, figuring that was the key element that would keep the group cemented together. And I did that. And slowly but surely, people either died or got enabled or their children took them away from Wilmington. And I inherited pretty much the whole nine yards, including the coffee. So I roped my wife in to do the coffee and stuff. And I've been doing it ever since. I like these guys. I think what they did was great. And I hope their memories live on, and I've done what I can to do that. Most of them now, the true World War II veterans, are in their 90s. Dick Daughtry is 95. Chuck Kroger is 93. Chuck was in the CIA, and I've tried to get him to give a program, and he can't talk about anything he did. lots of 92-year-olds. Bob Newman, who I think may come, is 92. He was a B-17 pilot in World War II. Justin Carnegie, he was a B-24 nose gunner. Now, he got to see action from right up there. We had another guy who gave a talk. He hasn't been real regular. He was a tail gunner in a B-24, got shot down 3 times. And for a while, we had members from every branch of the service, several of them. It seems like the Air Force guys have survived better than the others. Navy guy, we had Paul Weiser, who he was on the battleship North Carolina for the whole war. Another very interesting guy is Bud Hollenbeck. He is 94. He was at Pearl Harbor when they were bombed, and he spent the rest of the war on the battleship Pennsylvania, all across the Pacific. I've had him do programs because he's such an interesting guy. But he's 94. But you know what? He plays tennis every Wednesday. And that's why he can't make the meetings anymore.
It is a wonderful group that meets once a month. And I've had my grandfather was in World War II, and he attended the World War II Remembered group and got a lot of enjoyment out of it. Unfortunately, he's passed away. Mm. And my father, he was not in World War II, but he was in the Navy, mm-hmm. and he attends the group. So I know it's a wonderful group. Very honored to have you head that group up.
Well, see, I'm not a veteran. I didn't make any of the wars. It was just timing. World War II, I was a kid playing with plastic Jeeps. Korea, I was in the seventh grade. By the time Vietnam got hot enough for the draft, I had two kids, and I just missed them all.
So tell me, what advice do you have for someone in their 20s?
Like my grandsons?
That's right.
Get involved. Yeah, it's your country. You maybe think you can't have an impact, but that's no excuse. Get involved. Who said evil triumphs when good men do nothing? Gee, this is more about me than the World War II Remembered Group. Let me tell you one thing I'm doing right now. I'm trying to diversify the programs. And I've broadened out to other wars, figuring this is interesting to the Korean vets or the Vietnam vets. And I've had a little bit of success with that. The Vietnam vets are, they were hurt. The country rejected them. And they're really kind of in their shells. I did have a Vietnam vet 2 months ago. His name is Alan Lamb. And he was a wild weasel. I don't know whether the term means anything to you, but Vietnam, the North Vietnamese were buying surface-to-air missiles from the Russians. And our Air Force had not dealt with surface-to-air missiles, and they were shooting our planes down like. So a special task force was put together to find a solution to the SAMs. And the wild weasels were the result. And what they did was they'd take a plane up, and they had special radar detection gear on the plane, so when the SAM site started emitting radiation, they could find it. They would charge the SAM site and try to get it to launch a SAM missile, and the aircraft could turn quicker than the SAM missile, so they'd have this little dogfight, and then they'd go in and bomb the site where the missile was launched. And on top of that, they had five guys coming in behind him with real bombs to totally destroy it. Well, Alan Lamb was wild weasel number six. And he lives in Landfall, and he has this fantastic story of, so, and that got a big draw. I thought, maybe that'll get the Vietnam vets to come. And I hope it did. We've had Korea. In November, I'm having a Cold War. A woman who's going to tell about Germany after World War II. She's a professor at Ohio State. And I'd love to get somebody to talk about the Gulf War. I'm still searching. My hope, get some younger guys into the group that it can survive the deaths of all the World War II vets. I got a new suit for my grandson's wedding, and my wife and I were pondering the color, and I said, well, you know, I got to get something that'll work in a wedding, but boy, there's going to be a lot of funerals in the next 2 years.
Tell me what motivates you today.
What motivates me? I guess to keep busy. Yeah, I've been retired for 3 years. I had so many fights with IRS that I said, okay, guys, I'm going to retire, and you're going to have to find somebody else to fight with. So to do something productive. I want to do something kind every day. And certainly, to put out these programs for World War II Remembered. It's no 10-minute affair. It takes hours and days to put a program together. You know, part of it is finding an interesting speaker. Then you got to put the program together, and usually there's audio visuals that have to go with it.
So tell the audience when World War II Remembered meets.
World War II Remembered is on a regular schedule of the fourth Wednesday of every month at 10 o'clock in the ballroom at the Senior Center. However, in September we have our annual SOS breakfast. We just moved the time back to 8:30. It's still on the fourth Wednesday. But November and December, we always collide with Thanksgiving and Christmas, so we move back a week. So it'll be the second Wednesday in November and December.
And that group is open to the public?
Absolutely open to the public. It is free. We have a $1 donation that we buy the coffee and the supplies with. And so far, that's worked. I hate to have to hike the price.
So I know we talked about what motivates you, but what keeps you going every day?
Well, it used to be coffee, but I'm on decaf now. I don't know. I'm involved in some things and very active on the internet. In fact, when the internet was invented, or it came out, Al Gore invented it, you know. So I said to my kids, I said, you know, I'm going to be a very happy old fart. And so far, it's worked.
Good. Tell me, what's your favorite decade? Was it in your 20s, your 30s?
Probably my 30s. I mean, I was doing really interesting creative work and knew I was making an impact.
So looking back when you were in your growing up as a child or even in your 20s, what was your view of older adults?
Respectful. They had created this world I live in. Some cheated, but cheating happens. I had respect for my professors at Ohio State. I thought they knew a lot. And honestly, that has driven me into a lifetime of learning. I don't ever want to stop learning. One thing I run into this collision with the younger generation, including my grandson, is don't you want to know things? And his answer is, he pulls out his cell phone and he says, I can find out anything I need to know. I don't need to learn it. What if you run out of batteries?
So looking at older adults today, how do you view the older adult generation today?
Where would you, am I one of them, or are they younger or older than me?
Do you view them as being active and can, you know, you talked about continuing to learn. Do you see the older adult generation today different than it was 40 or 50 years ago?
I don't know whether I can give you a fair assessment of that, because I look at my high school classmates and I say, well, six or seven of us have risen to measures of success. Most of them stayed there, got married, had kids. Still live within 50 miles of the hometown, and that's all right. And I mean, that's their criteria. So if I judge today's, I guess my children generation versus that, it's about the same. The millennials, I think we've lost something. In fact, I use a couple of professors at UNCW to give programs to World War II. And I've asked one history professor, I said, how do you deal with these cell phones in your classroom? And he says, well, when I see the head down and the hands not visible, I know they're texting. And that's a problem. Yet I have asked Cape Fear Academy how they handle that problem. They said, well, we let the teacher decide. And I even asked one of the teachers, and he said, well, I'm laissez-faire about that. If I think it's interfering with the classroom or their learning, then I'll confiscate the cell phone till after the class.
And what do you look forward to as you get older?
A healthy exit. My dad always said, I want to die at the hands of a jealous husband. Yeah, really. Being part of that group for all these years, I've seen so many guys pass away, and most of them have gone pretty comfortably. Yeah, what I don't see is New Hanover County must have 5,000 World War II veterans, and I have 50 that come to my meeting. So I don't see all the misery and poverty that goes with being old. In fact, most of the ones in our group have been quite successful in life. They've made something happen.
And talking about New Hanover County, I know you moved here the day that I-40 opened.
Yep, 1990.
So how has New Hanover County changed?
Now, how has it changed? Well, it wasn't quite Little Wilmington anymore in 1990. It had started to sprout. But now we have traffic jams and murders. I guess Wilmington was pretty bad about murders. They had them all the time. We just didn't read about them. It's becoming a big city. It's inevitable. And I think now it's certainly tolerable if you know how to get around the traffic jams. My oldest daughter, she says, you take these god-awful shortcuts. And I said, okay, go up College at 8:30 in the morning and see how long you wait. But it's still a nice place. My wife and I have asked the question, where would we go if we didn't live here? It's like, you know, a place in the mountains for the summers would be nice, but.
You can't beat the beauty of the ocean.
No. The hurricanes. There's a couple that came and stayed with us. They're sort of exploring the way we did 26 years ago, where to move. Their kids are grown. They're from suburbs of Chicago. And I said, I really need to tell you about hurricanes. Oh. I said, yeah, before we moved here, we thought we researched them to death. We went down to a North Carolina room and read everything they had about hurricanes back to 1846, and we said, looks like they get hit about once every 25 years. So, we may get hit once before we die. We'll take our chances. I don't know how many we've had since then, probably 10 or 12. But miraculously, we, the Nelsons, have hardly had any damage whatsoever from all of them. I think we owe it to buried power lines.
Well, John, I appreciate you taking the time
well
and telling your story and
you're
your involvement here at the senior center, your involvement with our veterans.
Well, you're certainly welcome.
Appreciate that.
To learn more about the New Hanover County Senior Resource Center, visit our website at src.nhcgov.com or call 910-798-6400.